subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
There are two kinds of mechanisms that drive a supernova. When a massive star, which is over 10 times the mass of the sun, is about to die, it can collapse into itself from its mass and under its gravity and thus explode, becoming a supernova. This occurs when there's iron in the core of the star, and this is an iron core collapse supernova. Then there's thermonuclear supernova, where a white dwarf or a star that is up to 8 times the mass of the sun runs out of matter and then starts to suck in matter from a nearby white dwarf or merge with another star, eventually becoming so massive that it explodes. But there's also a third kind of supernova, something which was only theorized a few decades ago. This is called an electron capture supernova and produces neutron stars as remnants, just like the core collapse supernova does. But it occurs in stars that sit in this mass gap between these two kinds of supernova. So these stars are more than 8 times the mass of the sun, but less than 10 times the mass of the sun. Turns out, we might have actually observed one several centuries ago in bright daylight for many days together. The remnant of that is what we know today as the Crab Nebula. In this video, let's look at supernovae, their mechanisms, electron capture supernova, and our understanding of this kind of stellar physics. I'm Sandhya Ramesh, and this is Pure Science. Supernovae are some of the most violent phenomena that occur in the universe, and one supernova can actually expel many solar masses worth of material. And all of this material can travel very, very, very fast, a percentage of the speed of light. Naturally, then, there will also be a shock wave that pushes out all of this material, and this material can then birth newer stars in the future. When a supernova occurs, it is typically visible to the naked eye because of the intense light and energy that is emitted from it, and this makes it momentarily even brighter than the sun. This can last anywhere from a few seconds to a few days. During these times, the supernova would be visible like a bright star in the day sky. When do we see stars in the day sky? When the sun is out. That is why supernovae are so exciting to astronomers, and that is why there was so much fuss around Betelgeuse probably going supernova too, which we now know isn't happening currently. Additionally, there is also a very short number of stars that can go supernova in general because they do need to meet a set of mass and other stringent criteria. So with everything put together, supernovae in general are a rare occurrence, a once-in-a-lifetime occurrence. Today, we have enough equipment to monitor the skies with them efficiently, and we observe about 100 supernovae every year, although not with our naked eyes. And this is especially common because now we have started to detect supernovae outside of our Milky Way galaxy. The naming convention for a supernova is the prefix SN followed by the year of discovery and then one or two letters if needed if there are multiple supernovae in a year. It goes from capitals A to Z and then to small AABB and so on. We also have historic records of supernovae in the past. We have ancient astronomers from nearly all ancient civilizations who have made recorded observations of supernovae. There have been a few that even historically were globally recorded, such as the SN 1006 supernova, which occurred in the year 1006 in the constellation of Lupus. It is thought to be the brightest supernova on record, and it is in the literature of multiple ancient civilizations, including in India, China, Japan, some European nations, in Egypt, in the Mediterranean countries, and so on. Ancient Indian civilizations actually probably recorded the earliest recorded supernova, something called the HB9, which is described on a rock carving in Kashmir, and this dates to about 5000 BCE. Astronomers like Johannes Kepler and Tycho Brahe also observed and documented supernovae. The most widely observed one was SN 1054, which resulted in the Crab Nebula. And that's the one that we now think is the new kind of theorized supernova. SN 1054 occurred on the 4th of July of the year 1054. It remained visible in the sky until 6th April 1056. It has been recorded in Islamic astronomy, in Japanese literature, in Native American cultures, and even in some European sources. But it was most meticulously documented and observed by ancient Chinese astronomers of the time. What is left over after the bright supernova is the Crab Nebula, which, if you're an amateur astronomer, might know that it went on to become the first Messier object, or M1. This nebula is a supernova remnant, or what is left over after a supernova. It shows an expanding shockwave, and it shows material that is ejected from the expansion, and it is typically brightly colored because the material is often colliding with other material as well. Supernovae also result in stellar remnants, which is the ultimate physical object that is left over, the core, and this is called a compact object or a compact star. There are three kinds of compact objects. They are white dwarfs, neutron stars, and black holes. At the center of the Crab Nebula, the remnant is the Crab Pulsar, which is a neutron star that was left over from the supernova. Now, the Crab Nebula had undergone something called an electron capture supernova, the new kind that we're talking about today. This kind of supernova was actually theorized just in the 1980s. For other supernovae, we know some of the criteria, such as the Chandrasekhar limit, which is 1.4 times the mass of the Sun. Once a star crosses this mass, it can explode into a type 1a supernova. And that is because it undergoes a runaway accretion of mass. And then there is core collapse, when the core can no longer support against the gravity of the mass of the star. Electron capture, as the name suggests, is when a proton-rich nucleus of an electrically neutral atom captures an inner electron from within the same atom, and thus it changes a nuclear proton to a neutron. And this emits an electron neutrino, which carries the decay energy. These electrons normally repel each other, and this is called the electron degeneracy pressure, and matter cannot be compressed anymore into a smaller space because of this external pressure. So this is what mainly resists gravitational core collapse and prevents everything in a star from falling into a nucleus. But what happens inside the star itself during an electron capture supernova is that the internal pressure forces electrons to fuse with the nuclei. This causes pressure to drop, causing the core to collapse. This then results in a supernova and a remnant, which is typically a neutron star, just like with the other core collapse supernova. We have previously detected such a supernova in 2018 in the galaxy NGC 2146. This supernova, now called SN2018 ZD, helped astronomers observe and understand the conditions for identifying electron capture supernova. The new study that is out now examines this 2018 supernova and identifies six of these conditions. For electron capture supernovae, the star has to be between 8 to 10 times the mass of the Sun. The star should also have shed most of its mass before exploding. The shed mass would actually be made up of carbon and helium and nitrogen with almost no oxygen. When the star explodes, there is a weak explosion with no radioactive fallout, and the stellar remnant should be rich in neutrons. The astronomers realized that the Crab Nebula fits all of these criteria. The detailed findings on Crab Nebula now shine more light into the evolution of this fixture of astronomers than amateur astronomers. And astronomers can say with a fair degree of confidence now that the famous supernova, which was visible in the day for a few weeks and in the night for 2 full years, was a unique and rare electron capture supernova.